stingy with her product. Look at that. She's a good worker. You want to have that's the kind of people you want to have work. She gave them one fresh project. The 30 reporters outside.
Would you like two in a bag?
Two in a bag, yeah. Okay. Two in a bag.
Welcome to Hashtag Go Right with Peter Boykin, where we cut through the nonsense and get to the truth behind the headlines. And today we're talking about something that might surprise you. Sports. Now, I used to think the news media had a monopoly on political bias, but it looks like the sports media is trying to outdo them. Buckle in, folks. This might be a long podcast. There's a lot of great information today. Now, let me break it down to you. Recently, Donald Trump attended the NFL Steelers versus Jets game broadcast on NBC. And how many times did they show him on TV? Once. For 4 seconds. That's right. 4 seconds. Now, let's put that into perspective. When pop star Taylor Swift attends a game, she's shown an average of 7 times. I probably asked her to join the Kiss Cam, with some shots lasting up to 30 seconds. You have to ask why the glaring difference. This isn't just about football or fanfare. It's about media bias in every arena. Even in our sports, wherever it's news, entertainment, and now sports, the media is showing us that they're not interested in being fair. They're interested in controlling the narrative. If we don't speak out and push back, that bias only grows stronger. But that's where you come in. As we approach election season, it's more important than ever to stay informed and make your voice heard. Whether it's on the field, in the newsroom, or at the ballot box, we have to call out bias whenever we see it, and you can do that by voting. Stick with us at Hashtag Go Right with Peter Boykin, where we'll continue to break down the stories that matter, expose the bias, and fight for the truth, because it's just not about the left versus right. It's about right versus wrong. That's why I say Hashtag Go Right. We'll be right back. Remember, we fight for what's right because it's time to go right.
Time to go right. Time to go right. Time to go right.
Welcome to Hashtag Go Right with Peter Boykin, where we cut through the misinformation and bring you the real stories impacting our nation. Here we uphold the principles of liberty as outlined by our founders with a commitment to truth, fairness, and the well-being of our constitutional republic. Let's dive into the key issues of the day from GoRightNews.com. And you can find a follow-up article on GoRightNews.com with all this information. Once again, the Biden-Harris administration has sent another $400 million to Ukraine. And I just saw a video the other day. Ukraine is literally pulling people out of clubs, out of bars, off the streets, people who want to get out of Ukraine because they're not letting people out of Ukraine. They're pulling people to be fodder for the war, people who don't want to be a part of it. They want the war to end. But they're pulling them and they're paying big people money for people and troops who don't want to fight a war. I don't know about you, but when you have a fighting force full of people who are not interested in fighting, then you end up with targets or you end up with loss. And it's awful. Now, all the while, Americans are struggling to pay their basic needs at home. I, for one, every paycheck, it's already pretty much gone as soon as I got it. The month isn't long enough. It's too many bills. You turn around and, you know, the prices go up to eat. You know, I go pay all of a sudden to go buy a couple items at 17 some dollars at the store for nothing. A little meal of chicken to come from my dad. Not much. And things are getting worse. But $400 million more to Ukraine, while they say that they need to end the war in Israel, which I think Donald Trump's going to hopefully end all these wars. Now, the question is, where are our priorities? The American people deserve leadership that puts our country first, our people first, not one that sends our hard-earned money overseas without a clear plan on how it benefits us here at home, because it doesn't. This is why it's also important that we vote for leaders who understand the value of our constitutional republic and will focus on our nation's needs before others. Next up, Steve Bannon's imminent release signals a turning point. Conservative strategist Steve Bannon, a fierce defender of American values, is set to be released from jail soon, and his return to the political scene could be a game changer. For months, his absence has been felt, but his release serves as a reminder of the strength and resilience of those willing to fight for what's right in America. His voice will undoubtedly push back against the corruption that's plagued this administration, and we'll be watching closely. I mean, they sent this man to jail for refusing to go up and talk and basically purge himself or whatever. You know, he could have went up there and said, I plead the fifth. But they wanted to demonize Trump. They wanted him to try to say stuff and push stuff in his mouth. In this whole trial, they literally spent time to try to, you know, get rid of Donald Trump. And in reality, was the trial even valid? Nobody really wanted it. I think they voted against having a trial, and the Democrats went ahead and set up one anyway. And their so-called Republicans on the thing were not really Republicans. I would hate to see the word rhino, but they really hated Trump. Sent to jail for what, really? So Kamala Harris retreats from the campaign trail. Remember, she said that Donald Trump was exhausted. But as the election inches closer, Kamala Harris's campaign has spent $270 million just this past month. $270 million in a month. Yet instead of rallying voters in swing states, she's spending more time preparing for interviews with CNN and NBC, you know, the softball interviews, the ones that they will change. I mean, I think 60 Minutes said, oh, well, we sometimes edit our interviews to make them timely, and we want to remind people that Donald Trump didn't come, and the doors are open for Donald Trump to come, so we can not edit, or we can edit the interview to make Donald Trump look stupid. You know, this is a significant sign that her campaign is floundering. 2 weeks away from the election, candidates should be out in full force, not trying to change minds with media appearances, but this doesn't mean we should take anything for granted. Every vote counts, and voting early, especially in swing states, will be key to ensuring the future of our nation. And remember, October isn't over, for we can get more surprises. Well, with October surprise, I mean, honestly, if this was on real media, if there's real media existed, this would be a much bigger story. Hopefully, it'll come out as a bigger story. But leaked U.S. intelligence, a threat to national security and a shocking breach of trust. Classified U.S. intelligence detailing Israeli plans to strike Iran has been leaked by a pro-Iranian group. The fact that the sensitive information was posted publicly raises serious questions. Was this an intentional act by the Biden regime? Or is there a rogue element within our intellectual or intelligence agencies? Either way, it highlights the dangerous lack of accountability under this administration. Strong leadership is crucial to protecting national security, and we must elect leaders who will restore integrity to the highest levels of our government. I mean, folks, as they are trying to push the Ukraine war and say that we got to defeat Russia, we got to defeat Russia, pushing for us to continue that war, giving more money to that war. They're also, and I'm not saying I support Israel or don't support Israel. I don't really support anybody over there in the Middle East. I support peace in the Middle East that Donald Trump had. There at the same time, it seems like they are working against Israel in every way they can. And what surprises me is that the LGBT community would be so much hooked into the Democratic Party because they think the Democrat Party flying their rainbow flags and doing their events and saying, we love you, is in reality so great. But in reality, it's a hoax. Because what are they really doing? They're supporting the radical Muslims who would rather throw us off the buildings. That'll have nothing to do with us. As they'll, the left will joke about gays for Trump being roaches for raid, et cetera, et cetera. You've got Palestinians, you got gays for Palestine, gays for Muslim groups. Really? Just wrong. As we move towards Election Day, remember that your vote is your voice. In this crucial moment, the future of our constitutional republic is on the line. This time is to act, and it's now. The time to act is now. Vote early, vote wisely, and let's ensure that liberty and justice prevail for all Americans. Stay tuned for more hashtag Go Right with Peter Boykin, where the truth, where we stand for truth, liberty, and the enduring strength of our great nation. We'll be right back.
Inflation is a real issue right now. Keeping your money in a bank, that's become a bigger risk, especially with the recent collapse of some major banks. Cash is losing value just sitting there, but there's a smarter way to protect yourself. The best way to avoid inflation is to invest in something that has the potential to grow in value.
Welcome back to hashtag Go Right with Peter Boykin. This election isn't just about the candidates. It's about the election of our country. And your vote is your voice. Swing states will be the battlegrounds that decide the future of this nation. Don't wait until the last minute. Vote early and make sure your voice is heard. Now let's ensure that our constitutional republic thrives for future generations. I got three other big articles to talk about today. I told you it was going to be a big podcast today, and I hope you go through it all. And I do section these out, so you can always stop and come back through section, enjoy these podcasts, spread the information, share it to other people, follow the social media that I'm on, and catch up with it. I try to make these where they're easy to understand and that you can watch them out of order. I know some information gets dated a little bit, but I try to give you information that you can use in the long term. So let's start about the real price of the American dream. The price of achieving the American dream has skyrocketed to a staggering $4.4 million this year, pushing that cherished ideal further out of reach for millions of hardworking Americans. I'm one of those. This sharp increase is driven primarily by the relentless rise in inflation under the Biden-Harris administration, which has sent everyday costs soaring. Now let's break down the costs. According to an analysis by Investopedia, the price tag for hitting major life milestones has increased by a whopping $1 million from just a year ago. Here's a closer look at the financial burdens now associated with key elements of the American dream. Except for the last one's not exactly my American dream, but we'll get to that. Retirement, $1,599,995. You know darn well I will not have $2 million to retire on. Buying a home, $929,955. Yes, and I've seen homes, decent homes under that, but buying a great home, yeah, $1 million. Raising two children and paying for college, $832,172. Again, don't even know why people are going to college kind of anymore, because unless you're a certain way and you're in the right kind of field and you get the right opportunity, you're going to be like me with two master's degrees and not being able to get a job in your field. And we've explained the reason why. Meanwhile, purchasing new cars, $811,440, which includes, you know, paying for insurance that don't really cover your car, not really covering if the car breaks down, not really, you know, paying you out if you get in a car accident, a deer hits you, etc., and paying enormous prices for cars that as soon as you drive them off the lot, there goes the value. It's like taking it out of the box. Meanwhile, weddings, $44,300. Don't know who's spending that much money on a wedding, but hey. Caring for pets, $36,626. I can see that. We got two cats at home, got a couple of dogs at the other house. The two cats are eating all the food all the time. bugging the hell out of me constantly. Dogs, you know, dogs eat as much food as you lay down. So, yes, that's just food. Imagine the vet bills. And a lot of people can't afford their vets. And that's why a lot of the animal shelters are full. So if you're able to adopt a pet, adopt a pet. Annual vacations, 179,109 annual vacations. I don't know who's got $179,000 to pay for a vacation, but I guess this is talking about the American dream. If I get to go on vacation this year, I'm going to spend a couple of thousand and try to pay for it. And it takes all year to basically put it together to go. Hopefully I'll get to go. And funeral cost, and this is part of the American dream. That's just really not part of the American dream for me. But funeral cost, $8,453. Yes. That's what a lot of people are getting cremated, you know, or just throw me in a bag and throw me in the ground, you know. This comprehensive breakdown paints a grim picture for those striving to achieve the traditional markers of success in America. Now let's talk about inflation, the culprit behind rising costs. The central factor driving this dramatic increase in living costs is inflation. Caleb Silver, chief editor of Investopedia, points out that the inflation has surged by 21% under the Biden-Harris regime, hitting Americans squarely in their wallets. From groceries and gas to housing and healthcare, the price of everything has gone up, making it increasingly difficult for average Americans to keep up. No longer can we keep up with the Joneses, or we can't even keep up with the Javier's next door. We just can't. As inflation continues to rise unchecked, so too does the cost of pursuing the American dream. And then comes a dream deferred. The effects of this economic pressure are being felt across the nation. A recent poll revealed that 41% of Americans believe the American dream is now impossible to achieve. Many young families are putting off buying homes, delaying having children, and cutting back on other milestones that previous generations took for granted. With wages failing to keep pace with the cost of living, more Americans are wondering if the dream of upward mobility and financial stability is slipping through their fingers, and I believe it is. Now that brings us to the Trump factor, a vision for the future. In contrast to the current administration's economic challenges, Donald Trump recently penned an article in Newsweek offering a different path forward. Trump's vision focuses on rebuilding America's economic foundation through what he calls the New American Industrialism. His plan promises to create millions of high-paying jobs, raise wages, and turn the U.S. back into a global manufacturing powerhouse. I mean, taking those jobs back from China. I mean, that is the most important thing that we have to do, taking our jobs back. By bringing jobs back to America, Trump aims to restore the American dream to a reality that's obtainable for all, not just the wealthy. Meanwhile, all here is commercials where Kamala Harris, her answer for everything is, we're going to take money from the top 1%. The top 1%, the wealthy, they need to pay their fair share. They need to pay taxes. Well, that is why people left. That is why companies have invested in other countries. Because once they hit a certain cap here, why do they want to pay more taxes? And if they got to pay more taxes and more money comes out and they're not making as much, what happens to that? Then it trickles down. It is the trickle-down economy. And it affects us. So it doesn't protect the middle class, as she claims. And then they talk about, oh, Donald Trump is he's going to do tax cuts for billionaires and trillionaires. Well, who do you think has the jobs? These tax cuts, these things that they so-called did, was where you got repatriation of our money by, like, Apple, bring your business back to America. We'll cut taxes. We'll let you repatriate your money. We'll get you here. You can increase your businesses. So what if the big company saves money and has a price cut? As long as that price cut and that tax cut goes along with helping America and helping workers, then why not? And if they don't do that, then you don't give them cuts, right? Now, why it matters. The American dream is more than a concept. It's a promise of opportunity. freedom, and prosperity that has driven this nation forward for generations. But as the cost of basic life milestones continue to soar, Americans are increasingly finding themselves priced out of their own aspirations. In this time of economic uncertainty, voting for leadership that prioritizes the prosperity of American workers and families becomes more crucial than ever. As we approach a critical election, voters must decide which leaders are best equipped to bring the American dream back within reach. We'll be right back.
Back in a few minutes.
Thank you.
Okay, good. Hey, sweetheart. Hey. Come on, hon. Come on. We'll go over here. You take a dog, you go outside, it's freezing, and you walk around for a while, and it's not that easy.
Okay, be careful. The fact that she trusted me with that dog was amazing. Probably she shouldn't have, but it worked out.
Hello, everybody. Hey, Andy. How are you? Nice to see you. I'm going to help you.
First, give you an appropriate vest.
Okay.
You don't look like us. Please wrap.
Put that in the middle. Very nice. Now, let's go, Andy. Room service. Look at this. This is serious room service. I hope you give me a nice big fat tip. Have a good time. Hello, Mia.
Good morning, Mr. Trump.
How are you?
Always a pleasure.
Nice to see you again.
So you're going
to
help me do housekeeping today?
I am. Am I going to change this again?
Yes.
Let's go. Very nice, Mia.
Okay, so first we're going to start off with the bed.
Good.
So next, Mr. Trump, I'm going to need you to vacuum.
Okay. So where's the little release? Wow. So there's a little piece of lint. Now it's gone. You're great.
So now we're going to go to the bathroom. So
I'm not
to
in the bathroom.
To the sinks.
I don't know if I could ever do that job.
Yes, you can.
Only sinks, right? Okay.
Sorry, first, spray the sink.
Okay. I like that. I like this job, Mia.
Oh, then maybe you should come help me all the time.
Well, these are four jobs that I've never done before, and they're tough. You have to be sharp, you have to be smart, you have to get along with the people, and it's hard work.
You know what? Kamala Harris is a fracking liar. Kamala Harris is once again under fire for her shifting stance on a crucial issue, fracking. This vice president, who has consistently wavered on this topic throughout her political career, is now claiming she supports fracking, despite previous advocating for a ban. This flip-flopping on one is the most critical issues of American energy independence raises questions about her credibility. Now, let me talk about the flip-flop. Kamala's campaign recently found itself in hot water after Camilla Thorndike, Harris's climate engagement directory, director, said, quote, she's not promoting the expansion of fracking. She's just said that they wouldn't ban fracking. Now, this statement directly contradicts Harris's earlier remarks during an interview in August. She told CNN's Dana Bush that she had no intention of banning fracking, saying, quote, as vice president, I did not ban fracking. As president, I would not ban fracking. But here's where the inconsistency lies. During the 2019 Democratic primaries, Harris made it clear that she was in favor of a ban, stating, there is no question I am in favor of banning fracking. This makes her latest claim seem like an attempt to walk back previous commitments in an effort to appeal to voters in swing states where fracking jobs are essential. In many ways, this flip-flopping is reminiscent of a European soccer player's dramatic on-field dives designed to fool the audience but obvious to anyone who's paying attention. Now, what's really at stake? At its core, this debate over fracking goes beyond political rhetoric. Fracking is vital to the U.S. energy industry, contributing to both energy independence and the livelihood of many American workers. Kamala's recent stance attempts to toe the line between appeasing environmentalists and not alienating workers in states like Pennsylvania, where fracking is a key issue. However, she restricts new leases for fracking, even without calling for an outright ban, the effect could be just as damaging as to the industry. Kamala may think she's playing a clever word game, you know, that word salad she loves, but voters aren't so easily fooled. By limiting the expansion of fracking, her policies could undermine the long-term health of this vital sector, jeopardizing American jobs and the nation's energy security. I mean, because we got to find other ways than just oil. We got to do as much as we can. If fracking works, we need to fracking do it. Now, the backpedal. To make matters worse, after her climate engagement director's comments caused a stir, Thorndike attempted to clarify, going, quote, "I didn't explain myself clearly here. Contrary to Trump's claims, the VP has not banned fracking." This consistent, need to clarify statements only adds to the confusion and makes it difficult for voters to trust where Harris truly stands on the issue. You remember, these remind me of the people, like, January 6th was so horrible and people broke and entered, but let me open the door. Let me help you come in here, 83-year-old woman. Come on in. Come on into the Capitol. Oh, my God, you broke into the Capitol. I mean, come on. Now, the industry's response to this whole fracking issue. The U.S. oil and gas, there's a lot of fracking jokes to be fracked about. U.S. Oil and Gas Association, known for its biting commentary, took us to social media to call out Harris's consistent reversal. They trolled her campaign on X, saying, wait, change of plan from earlier this morning. As of this afternoon, Harris now supports fracking, which is a change of position from this morning in which they opposed fracking, which was a change from their July position in which they supported fracking, which was a change from their June position in which they opposed fracking. Got it? Got it? I don't fracking got it. Now, this mocking tone reflects the growing frustration felt by those in the energy sector who have been whiplashed by Kamala's constantly shifting positions. Now, it's not just about the change in rhetoric. It's about policy decisions that impact real jobs, real families, and the future of American energy independence. And why does this all matter? As we inch closer to Election Day, Kamala's repeated flip-flops on fracking, try to say flip-flops, fracking flip-flops on fracking 10 times fast. If Sally sells seashells by the seashore to frick frack the frickin' frack of the frack frickin' flip-flop of fracking, illustrates a deeper issue, her inability to stick to a position when political winds shift. This lack of consistency is critical when Peter Piper picked a pack of pickled peppers in an election where voters need to know where candidates stand on key issues like energy independence, jobs, and the fracking economy. For the American people, especially those in swing states like Pennsylvania and Ohio, this issue goes beyond political games. It's about livelihoods and the future of our nation's energy policy. So voters must weigh the consequences of supporting a candidate who is yet to demonstrate a firm stance on this vital issue. And in the end, it's clear Kamala Harris is playing both sides. But the American people deserve leaders who are straightforward and consistent, especially on issues as critical as energy independence. The stakes are way too high for political gamesmanship. We'll be right back.
Well, first of all, thank you so much, President, for your time. My name is Eduardo Verástegui, and I am very grateful to this nation for opening the door to my dreams. This nation has been such an amazing blessing in my life. God bless America. God bless Mexico, and God bless Hispanic America. And let's make America and Mexico and Hispanic America great again. Together, pro-life again. Healthy again and free again. I met these heroes 10 years ago in Los Angeles, California, ex-Navy SEALs, ex-CIA agents, and they traveled around the world undercover rescuing children. And when they told me in details what they do and how they rescue these children, my eyes were open. And I said, I'm a filmmaker, I wanna make a movie about this, because the first step to eradicate child trafficking is to raise awareness. Because if you don't know that this problem exists, how you can fix it? So I made a promise to God that I will dedicate my entire life to end child trafficking. Yeah. To end child trafficking. Because God's children are not for sale. Children are sacred. And I am very grateful with you, Mr. President, dear amigo, dear hermano, because of you hosting a private screening in your house, because of you endorsing Sound of Freedom. After that, Sound of Freedom became the number one independent film in box office ever in history produced by a Mexican producer. Thank you for that. Thank you for the incredible hard work you're doing. Thank you for putting the children first. And that's why it's so important, is for all the media, for all Mexican Americans, Hispanic Americans, to vote for President Trump. And I know we will win for the third time. For the third time. Yes. Yes. We will win for the third time. And that's a fact. It's not an opinion. It's a fact. Because it's true. Because it's true. Look what is happening right now. Look what is happening right now with these evil people. Obama, Hillary, Kamala, Kamala, Joe Biden, Sleepy Joe, all this team. There's more than 300,000 children, over 300,000 children that they came through the border, they released them, and we don't know where they are. Kamala, where are the children? Kamala, where are the children? You know, these people, Kamala and Biden, they're the biggest human traffickers in the history. And everyone knows that. And that's why I'm here to give my 100% to support my dear friend, President Donald Trump. And again, we will win for the third time. God bless you. God bless you, Mr. President.
Really nice. Thank you.
We need to put you in the White House back again, in the beautiful White House. You're going to be in the beautiful White House again.
Welcome back from our fracking break. Let's talk about a subject that they don't like us to talk about, which is the reason why it's the last subject we're going to talk about today. So we got to beat the algorithms and hope that their robots don't read this far. And I know a liberal that really loves it because I went by a billboard today, a digital billboard that said in North Carolina that says vote no on the constitutional amendment, which our constitutional amendment here in North Carolina is supposed to be about will a immigrant non-citizen be allowed to vote in our elections, which should be a gimme that if you don't live in this country, that you shouldn't vote in this country. But they got to make an amendment. Somebody out there thinks it's a good idea to go ahead and let all the people pouring through the borders just vote. No, it's not going to happen. So let's talk about illegal immigration, the root of economic and social discontent. In recent years, illegal immigration has been a critical issue plaguing America with ripple effects that span economic, social, and security concern. While some argue that that immigration strengthens the nation, the reality is that illegal immigration, in particular, brings with it a host of unplanned, unregulated, and unwanted consequences. And as we examine the situation objectively, it becomes clear that illegal immigration, not lawful regulated immigration, is the heart of many of America's current economic and social problems.
Now, a lot of immigrants are Indians and Pakistanis, for instance, and I like curry. But now that we've got the recipe, is there really any need for them to stay?
Let's talk about the economic disruption. One of the most significant challenges illegal immigration poses is its effects on the American job market. As companies move toward modernization and technology-driven solutions, there are already fewer opportunities for the blue-collar factory jobs that once sustained the middle class. Coupled with this, illegal immigrants often enter the labor market willing to accept substandard wages and conditions, making it harder for American citizens to find jobs that pay fair wages. Employers exploit this, hiring illegal workers to reduce costs, but it leads to widespread job displacement for American citizens. And believe me, I know for a fact that I worked at multiple places where they will work these illegals as long as they can until somebody comes along and really says that they got to go and you got to check the green cards, et cetera, et cetera. But these people aren't traced and they swap green cards away and nobody checks that somebody, Hector, is working 20 jobs at one time. It's not humanly possible. Now, moreover, illegal immigrants tend to settle in low-income neighborhoods where affordable housing is already scarce. Since many are used to overcrowded living conditions, they can afford to share homes in undesirable areas, driving up demand and prices for housing that used to be within reach of low-income American citizens. This causes a housing squeeze that hurts American families, particularly those living in economically disadvantaged areas. By crowding into affordable housing and accepting substandard conditions, illegal immigrants raise the cost of living and make it more difficult for legal residents to find decent housing at reasonable prices. This is the reason you do the house hunting. I told my dad, you know, we've got this little place, it's paid for, and we can't afford it. Luckily, my other half, we have another place, and it's a small place. Both of them are paid for. Thank God we're not on the renting market, but we looked at the renting market. It's twice as much as it was when I was struggling just to pay for the rent at that time. Now it's twice or three times. I don't even know. Look, I get paid decently, but my whole month's paycheck would probably basically pay for like a month's rent. So nobody can live by themselves anymore. You got to have roommates. You got to have other people. You got to live with family. We got to change our whole social structure of people leaving home, the empty nest. There's no empty nest anymore. People got to stay home with their parents, live in the basement. I mean, that's kind of why we joke about, you know, the liberals are living in their mom's basement. Well, it's kind of because of that, you know, and are they helping their parents out? That's another thing. So let's lead us to the social strain and crime. Socially, the influx of illegal immigrants has contributed to the deterioration of quality of life in certain areas. The growing presence of foreign-born gangs, particularly from Latin America, has led to increased crime rates in urban centers. In cities like New York, reports have shown how certain neighborhoods have been taken over by criminal organizations linked to illegal immigrants, creating unsafe environments for families and law-abiding residents. The problem is compounded by the fact that law enforcement resources are stretched thin as they deal with the growing number of non-citizens committing violent crimes. And contrary to some studies that claim illegal immigrants commit fewer crimes than native-born citizens, real-world data paints a different picture. While it's true that not every illegal immigrant is a criminal, the criminal elements among them are responsible for a significant share of violent crimes. But I'll stop you there. Every illegal alien who crosses the border is actually a criminal because they illegally entered. They trespassed. And last time I checked, trespassing is a crime. Now, this includes gang violence, drug trafficking. Now, these illegal activities devastate communities. They make it difficult for law-abiding citizens to feel safe in their own neighborhoods. That's why you're seeing a lot of pushback now. And then you're also seeing the strain on public resources. Just ask the mayor of New York, who now that because he spoke up about it, guess what? They're going after him now because he stepped out of line. But the strain of public resources, illegal immigration also burdens public resources such as healthcare, education, and welfare services. Hospitals in border states are overwhelmed by the need to provide emergency care for illegal immigrants, often without receiving any compensation. School districts, particularly in states like Texas and California, are also struggling to accommodate an influx of non-English speaking students, which requires additional resources, teachers, and funding to provide quality education. Taxpayers are left to foot the bill for services provided to illegal immigrants, putting a strain on an already overburdened system. Moreover, illegal immigrants who work under the table often do not contribute to Social Security or other public benefits programs, yet they still make use of services designed for citizens and legal residents. This leads to a significant financial imbalance where American taxpayers are shouldering the costs of supporting individuals who are not contributing their fair share to the system. Oh my God, there's that word, fair share. Democrats love it when it comes to rich people, but, you know, getting people to contribute a fair share doesn't really happen. Now, you're probably wondering why I went on this whole thing, and I've still got a little bit more left, but there was a opinion article I saw flash across, because I look for things to talk about. There's an opinion article on Newsweek that talked to, it was an opinion like, oh, quit saying that illegal immigration is the cause of social and economic disaster, and quit this warmongering and this hate speech and blah, blah, blah. So I kind of wanted to put this together as kind of a direct response to that BS article opinion. So that leads us to flawed notions. The notion that illegal immigration is harmless or even beneficial to the U.S. is deeply flawed. The economic and social issues tied to unregulated illegal immigration are undeniable. From job displacement and housing shortages to crime and the strain on public resources, the evidence points to illegal immigration as a major cause of many of the problems Americans face today. While lawful immigration can be beneficial and has long played a role in building America, illegal immigration is a different story. It undermines the system that is designed to welcome immigrants in a fair, orderly, and regulated manner. For the sake of American workers, the economy, and national security, it is crucial to address and resolve the issues stemming from illegal immigration. Instead of turning a blind eye to the real problems it causes, ignoring these issues only exacerbates the economic struggles and social unrest that have become all too common in many parts of this country. Do you hear me, Kamala Harris, border czar? You're just ignoring the problem. The solution lies in enforcing immigration laws, securing the borders, and ensuring that those who come to the United States do so legally. And I'm not talking about typing up on a CBB app and all of a sudden, hey, I'm here. I don't know if that's law legal or not, but that needs to be stricken. Because nobody should be able to just pull out an app, type in, hey, I'm here, and just enter the border. No. People need to come to the United States legally. They need to contribute positively to the nation's future rather than exacerbating its challenges. Legal. With that, we'll be right back with hashtag GoRights Recap Remix. Yes, it's been a long podcast, but a lot of information. Huge information. Huge. Hope you like it. Be right back.
The border's wide, the fence is far, and the weight on our nation grows tall. Jobs once secure, now slipping through, as wages drop for me and you. Housing scarce, prices climb, while illegal waves grow over time. It's a fight we can't ignore, this isn't what the dream was for. Oh, we stand, but the dreams fade fast, illegal types are breaking the facts. Go Light News, we speak for the brave. Constitutionalists for America will say the same. The streets feel darker, crime runs high, as broken laws cloud the sky. Schools overfilled, they struggle to cope, while honest families lose their hope. Puzzled systems drain, stretch thin, but we know where the change begins. Enforce the rules, secure our way, bring back the dream. It's time to say, hey, we arise with the truth as our shield. For the American dream, we won't yield. Go Light News, let the light shine through. Constitutionalists, we fight for you. Inflation climbs, the pressure's on. The price of freedom feels overgone. But the spirit of this land won't die. We'll stand tall, we'll fight, we'll try. Illegal floods, they weaken the land, but together we'll make our stand. Restoring hope, bringing pride, with unity we'll turn the tide. We'll march with liberty at our side, for the American dream with strength and pride. Go Right News, we'll lead the fight. Constitutionalists defending what's right. What's right? Restoring hope, bringing pride. With unity, we'll turn the tide. We'll turn the tide.
Welcome back to the Hashtag Go Right Recap Remix. If you made it this far, thank you for tuning in to Hashtag Go Right News. I know this has been like a double long episode. It's a lot of information to go on. And if you reached that far, this far, thank you. Share it to others. Share them the points that you think's the best. Use this information. You can go to GoRightNews.com to find all this information is written down. If you want to reach out to us, we'll gladly talk to you about what's going on. And if you have any ideas for new stories in the future, let me know. So let's do our recap. The American dream is slipping further out of reach, with the cost now skyrocketing to $4.4 million, driven by inflation under the Biden-Harris regime. Kamala Harris can't seem to decide if she's for or against fracking, flip-flopping like a soccer player trying to win over voters. And let's not ignore the hard truth: illegal immigration is straining our economy, driving up housing prices and creating social issues like crime in major cities. The stakes are high, and we can't afford to ignore what's happening. So for more insights and updates, visit GoRightNews.com. Follow GoRightNews on Rumble.com. And don't forget to catch Hashtag GoRight with Peter Boykin on YouTube, TikTok, Facebook, X, Twitter, and beyond. If you believe in our cause, consider donating through the Cash App at $PeterBoykin1, and you can find all the links on GoRightNews.com and PeterBoykin.com. Now let's keep pushing for truth and fighting for America's future. Let's go right. Stay tuned for more updates on Hashtag GoRightNews with Peter Boykin. And remember, it's not just about left versus right. It's about right versus wrong. God bless everybody. Peace.
Donald J. Trump is now President of the United States. President Obama is the ex-president. And Mr. Trump, for the moment, steps
away from the inaugural
address.
Honor to be able to introduce for the first time ever anywhere the 45th President of the United States of America, Donald
Trump. On the table, we're just going to have to find as a tall man.
I am so sorry to my world. I am so sorry to my world. This is not what we want.
We will face
challenges. There's so much potential.
We will get the job done.
For beauty and for devastation.
Every 4 years we gather
in this one moment, it's almost incomprehensible that they can exist right now.